Orion presents Treason of Sparta by Christian Cameron, read by Peter Noble. Prologue.
Here we are again, friends. I promised you a hunt, and Thrace is the place to hunt. The game is better here than it ever was in my boyhood on Kithaeron, or in the hills of Attica. By Hera, there are still lions and bears here, and big deer fit for Artemis herself will not be clubbing rabbits for our meals. And since you've been kind enough to fill this two-handled cup to the brim with unwatered wine, and to have my pais bring it to me, I feel that you honor me. And what can I give you in return but a story? Well, I am well known for my stories, I think. So set your hunting spears aside, fill your cups and place them by you. Stretch out by the fire, and let's have a tale. Indeed, we'll have a circle of tales, will we not? For I am not the only voice speaking at our fire circle, and others will tell you of far-off places and other wars, other ships, other men and women, heroes and cowards and victory and defeat, and the gods who walk among men. But tonight, there are some new faces here, so I'll remind you of how we got here. You may recall that at my daughter's wedding, I told you of the long war from my boyhood on the slopes of Mount Kithaeron, where my father was a great bronze smith and my mother was a hard-drinking aristocrat, to the events of the modern age, the terrible defeat of the Greeks at Lade, the stunning victory of the Battle of Marathon, the tragedy of Thermopylae, the wasted victory of Artemisium, and the desperate victory of Salamis. And finally, I told you of the day of the Rage of Ares, the greatest battle of our time, fought at my hometown of Plataea between Mardonius, leading the great king of Persia's mighty army, against us, the coalition of all the Greeks. Well, let's be honest, a coalition of Athens and Sparta, with some other cities trailing along with us. Too many gave earth and water to the Medes. Thebes, first and foremost. But enough of us stood our ground and fought, and in the end, the Spartans and the Athenians defeated the Persians. Aye, and the Megarans and Corinthians and some others. But we did a hard week's work and got it done, and a bloody harvest it was. At my daughter's wedding feast, I ended my story by talking about the rebuilding. And that, my friends, is where I'll take up the tale tonight. I'll miss my daughter's friend, with hair of fire, who blushes so freely and so brightly. And I'll miss my wife's soft hands, reminding me to keep the story within the bounds of social acceptability. And perhaps I'll drink too much. These are times for wine and friends. And tomorrow we can run off our wine fumes and kill a boar. But, as is so often the case, I've left my course. It was the year after the supposed end of the long war to free Greece. It was the year that Timosthenes was Archon Basileus in Athens. It was the year my friend Asthilos of Croton won every running event at Nemea and established himself as the greatest athlete of my generation. It was the year that I was Archon in Plataea. It was the year in which the Spartan strategos, Pausanias, the victor of Plataea, and Greece's greatest commander, rose high in the eyes of men and thought himself the best man in Greece. It was the year we thought to take the war to the Persians. At least, some of us thought so, as you will hear. This is the story of that year.
Book 1. Athens and Ionia. Late Winter, 479 to 478 BCE. Perceiving that the Athenians were going to rebuild their walls, the Lacedaemonians sent an embassy to Athens. They would have themselves preferred to see neither her nor any other city in possession of a wall, though here they acted principally at the instigation of their allies, who were alarmed at the strength of Athens's newly acquired navy and the valor which she had displayed in the war with the Medes. They begged her not only to abstain from building walls for herself, but also to join them in throwing down the walls that still held together of the other cities. The real meaning of their advice, the suspicion that it contained against the Athenians, was not proclaimed. It was urged that so the barbarian, in the event of a third invasion, would not have any strong place, such as he now had in Thebes, for his base of operations, and that Peloponnese would suffice for all as a base both for retreat and offence. After the Lacedaemonians had thus spoken, they were, on the advice of Themistocles, immediately dismissed by the Athenians, with the answer that ambassadors should be sent to Sparta to discuss the question. Themistocles told the Athenians to send him off with all speed to Lacedaemon, but not to dispatch his colleagues as soon as they had selected them, but to wait until they had raised their wall to the height from which defence was possible. Meanwhile, the whole population in the city was to labour at the wall. The Athenians, their wives and their children, sparing no edifice, private or public, which might be of any use to the work, but throwing all down. Thucydides, History of the Peloponnesian War, Book 1, Chapter 90.
My story begins, as it so often has, with the spring trading fleets coming in from Sicily. By the spring of the year after Plataea, I owned 4 warships, all laid up in my own boat sheds just over the mountain from Plataea, and 6 round ships, varying in size from a small tub that could just carry a few hundred big amphorae of wine or olive oil, to the new Poseidon, a slab-sided monster that could carry almost 6,000 medimni of grain. I'd paid for her to be built to keep the Corinthian shipwrights in business over the winter, but I'd imagined that she might play a role in the grain trade with Egypt, because I could guess that it would be a few years before the farmers of Attica and Boeotia had recovered. I also had the Leto, who'd been all but rebuilt over the winter, so that she had shining new wood, golden in the spring sunlight, stark against the grey-brown of the older wood in her hull, and the Io. Hector, my adopted son, took the Leto, as he had in the year of Plataea, and Hipponax, my son by Gaia, took the Io, and they were away in the first blush of spring. If you're not a sailor, listen. Greece is a country made by the gods for sailors, and not least because the land trails away into the sea in many directions, allowing a good captain to get off a beach in almost any wind. My sons were not taking such a foolish risk so early in the year. They could run down the Gulf of Corinth, past Naupactus, all the way out into the Italian Sea, and never be so far from land that a man couldn't swim ashore. And then, a single day's sail and they were in Croton, or one of the other Greek colony cities in Magna Graecia, and they could stay in with the coast around the toe of the boot, and then for Syracuse on the first good wind. They were joined by Lucas, who'd come over the mountains from Piraeus to take the big grain ship. He was the best of my captains in any weather, Now that Megacles and Myrrhe had their own ships and their own business. We loaded all three ships with whatever we could find to trade. Hides, mostly, and some salt, and linen from the year before, and some loot. I remember loading one of the great tents that the Persians had left behind, and some Persian bows. It was an oddly jumbled cargo, but Lucas also had gold and silver to buy things we needed, and a long order list made up by half the citizens of Green Plataea, roof tiles and fabrics and statues and ironware, and grain. My sons were right sailor men, and Lucas was the toughest helmsman afloat, for all that he was a wild-haired Briton from the other end of the world. And the weather was surprisingly mild. Indeed, we were in for one of the best summers any of us could remember. And none of that kept me from worry, so that every 2 or 3 days I'd ride down to Prosili, our little port on the Gulf of Corinth, and look out over the flat blue sea and wonder where they were. And I made a dozen sacrifices to Poseidon in the first week alone, and more as the month drew on. It was the new moon of Elaphivolion, as we reckon it in Boeotia, when they came sailing back across the gulf. A west wind wafted them all the way from Patras, and Hector bragged as he landed and kissed the beach that they hadn't touched the steering oars for 200 stadia. And there was Megacles in a newly built trireme. It was the heavy Phoenician type, and had clearly been built to carry cargo. But his rowers filled the beach, and he himself was proud of his ship. He was full of news from the west, news of Sicily and Massalia, where Dula and Sekla had their warehouses. Why were a couple of Africans running a small trading empire in Gaul? That's another story you'll have to hear another night, my friends. Although if you stay with me, you'll hear why it matters to this tale. In Patras, they say the Spartans don't want to fight Persia anymore, Megacles said. Hector, my adopted son, stopped embracing his own friends and came across the sand to me. It's true, pater, he said. I heard the same in Syracuse. They say the Ephors want to send all the Ionians to colonize Italy. Or do we call it Magna Graecia now? I'm sorry to keep playing old tunes, but of course this was what the Sparta first faction had wanted in the year of Plataea. What they'd always wanted. Ionia removed. I thought of what my wife, Briseis, who had once been queen of Ionia, might say. I thought of what my brother-in-law and lifelong friend and enemy, Archilogos, might say. And for the first time in many months, I wondered if the war with Persia was actually over. Again, I have to digress. At the same time that the allied Greeks faced Mardonius and the Persian army at Plataea, the allied Greek fleet, led by the king of Sparta, pressed eastwards into the maritime heart of the Persian Empire, Ionia. Based first from Delos, and then farther east, the allied fleet was cautious at first. But in the end, at Mycale, we caught the Persian fleet and routed it at sea, and then captured and burnt the Persian camp on land. And the Ionians, for the most part, liberated themselves on the spot. Remember, friends, that Ionia is where the revolt against the Persians began. Remember that the Ionians lost and were defeated and had satraps placed over their cities, so that they were forced to send contingents to fight us, the Western Greeks. At Salamis, most of the best ships serving the great king came from the Greek cities of Asia Minor. And while I'd never say this to a crowd of Spartiates, the truth is that Mycale hurt the great king a good deal more than Plataea. At Plataea, he lost a great army, Most of it was made up of his own fractious subjects, Medes and Indians and Egyptians and Africans. And they were losses he could make up in an afternoon. But at Salamis and Mycale, the Phoenicians were hammered, and the Ionians, in the end, changed sides. And suddenly the great king had no fleet. Let me add that Sicily was not a different world, and the tyrant Ialion had just defeated the ships of Carthage, robbing the Phoenicians of their greatest allies and their most likely source of reinforcements. In the aftermath of Mycale, the Spartan king, Leotichidas, kept most of the fleet together and went to the Dardanelles to cut the cables for the great pontoon bridge by which Xerxes, the great king, kept sending reinforcements to Europe. But after that, he sailed home with the Spartan contingent, declaring the war to be over, while the Athenians attacked the Chersonese and took it. More by luck, if the truth be told, than by skill, or so I've been told. I wasn't there, but Mire was, in the Black Raven, with my sons. I'd gone home by then to be a Plataean. Enough of the world and war. Except you need to understand this. At Plataea, we saved the freedom of Greece. But at Salamis and Mycale, we ended the possibility of further Persian interference in our affairs. Or so we thought. The Persian fleet was defeated, if not destroyed. Ponder that while you drink your wine, and I'll go back to my story. I left the beach with Megacles and Hector and Hipponax, and we rode back to my farm over the shoulders of the mountain on mules, far more sure-footed than horses on the steep trails, and we were in the old tower by nightfall. Achilles, my cousin, had given me back the farm after the battle. So many Plataeans had fallen in the great contest, the Argon, as we called it, that there was better farmland and to spare all down the valley, available to any man with a strong stomach for burying the dead, or burning them. So we rode up the hill as we might have 20 years before, and into the yard of what had been my father's house. And Briseis came down to the yard, dressed in a long, flowing Ionian-style chiton of transparent wool, with a narrow edging of gold and purple. Briseis, dressed as a woman of Ionia, was not a sight commonly seen in Plataea, where women tended to a severe peplos with a long, modest overfold. I remember her standing there in her purple and gold, the personification, if you will, of all our civilization. She welcomed my guests with wine and barley and cheese, and I was proud to see that although neither Hector nor Hipponax were the sons of her body, she embraced each before she kissed Megacles on the lips, which caused him to squirm in a way that made the rest of us laugh. "You bring my sons home," she said to me. "What reward can I give you?" I thought of my mother, drunk in her rooms, and my father taking out his anger on his bronze. And I pondered how I, the killer of men, had come to have so much happiness in my life. "I need no reward," I said. "Get a room," Lucas leered. "Enough domestic bliss." Briseis smiled her Ionian Aphrodite smile and led us into the hearth, where she made the matron's prayers before we set to a meal. She was a priestess of Aphrodite, and she had a household shrine to Hera and Athena, and we made the rounds, so to speak. Briseis practiced more piety than I was used to, but I liked it, and I loved her seriousness in ritual, her face turned to the rafters in invocation. Lucas, Megacles, and my sons took turns giving her the news from Sicily and the Peloponnese, and she nodded. "Listen, friends, Most Greek women are superb at managing a house or making a kikeon. But my wife had been a queen, and could be again. And she was as good at politics as Aristides or Miltiades. And so she listened with a different ear. That being said, we'd arrived at ways and means, you might say, and so she waited until they were all gone to our newly built guest quarters, before she lay back on a kline and waved her hand.
The Spartans don't want Ionia to thrive, she said.
I nodded. She poured herself a little wine and watered it.
Do you know what they fear?
She asked me. I shrugged. The modern world? I asked. There had been a time when I'd hated Sparta, but Yorgo and Spartius had changed that for me. I now admired almost everything about Sparta, except their treatment of their helots and their cowardly, cautious efforts. She smiled the smile women use when they see that men are not entirely fools.
Exactly, my husband, she said. They fear that Athens will rally the Ionians and make them strong.
Athens? I asked. Athens is a burnt husk of itself without a working temple.
Now you sound like a Spartan, she said. Athens has the mightiest fleet on ocean, and Persia, however fast her satraps rebuild, has nothing this evening to float on the sea. Athens can dictate almost any course she wants. Athens is also the last state standing with a merchant fleet, so she's going to control trade. She is about to be the richest city in the world. Athena must be pleased with her city.
I nodded. I admit, when I recall these conversations, I'm probably adding together many such. Certainly, Briseis and I discussed the future of our world. The world of Hipponax and Hector and her sons, too. So allow me to misremember, because the thing that I hadn't seen, and she had, despite all my years as a pirate, was that Athens, not Sparta, now held the upper hand. Regardless, what I do remember from that day was her view of the Spartans.
They cannot allow Athens to lead, and as they see the phoenix rise from the ash, she predicted, they will fear her more and more.
She looked out over our farm, sadly.
Come, husband, sit by me. I am sad, because what I foresee is the diminution of my people. Athens will steal the art from Ionia and make herself great. And what will become of Miletus and Mytilene and Samos? Will we Aeolians and Ionians become satellites of great Athens?
I thought of her brother, my rival and friend Archilogos. Somehow I doubt that.
And yet Ionia is vulnerable, she said. We need to be sure that Athens at least does not abandon the Ionians.
Do we? I was probably running a hand over her thigh at that point. She brushed my hand away.
Yes, husband, we do. And let me remind you that we are in an open room with slaves and 10 guests, and that perhaps your thoughts should be on packing for your trip to Athens.
Athens?
My dear, she said, did I forget to mention? Aristides has sent for you.
It might have been simpler to mount a horse and ride to Athens. In the spring of the year after Plataea, I owned more horses than I'd ever owned. The Persians had left Boeotia rich in their abandoned horse flesh, and I had a big Nisaean, several fine Arabs, and a variety of decent small horses useful for work, as well as 12 mules. But Megacles wanted to get back to sea, and he was taking his cargo around to Piraeus via the Diolcos, the stone road for ships. I chose to sail with him, and so instead of riding a fine horse for Athens over Mount Kithaeron, I packed my best himation and some carefully chosen gifts on mules and went back to Prosili. I kissed my wife, and we made sacrifices, and I was pleased to see that she was welcomed by the old priestess of Hera. Our temple was destroyed, our beautiful, if primitive, wooden Hera burnt by the barbarians. But someone's private votive statue stood behind the altar on an old table, and the priestess had survived, and we said the prayers. All over Greece that spring, people prayed in ruined temples and amid destruction, because the barbarians had savaged our holy places. I did stop at Simon's new farm to ask him to look after my vines, and I mention this to show that in the year after the great battle, the Corvaxi were once again a single family. We'd made the spring sacrifices together for the first time in a generation. We looked at our burned houses, and we worked together to rebuild. I'm glad I stopped to visit him, because my mood was light riding over Kithaeron's seaward shoulder, and I was ready, if anyone is ready, to receive the bad news that was waiting for me there. When I'd ridden down 2 days before, I'd ordered old Poseidonos, often my lead oarsman on the Lydia, and now retired to the honorable post of watchman on my ship sheds, to haul out my warships for a spring drying. I had a mind to put the Lydia in the water. The old pirate in me suggested that as we were still in a state of war against Persia, the whole Carian coast and the Egyptian delta might be fruitful sources of income. I need to remind you, my friends, that in the aftermath of the Persian invasion, despite the loot of their camp, 2 campaigns of burning and looting by the great king's army had left us poor and hungry. People died in the winter after we defeated Mardonius. We needed grain, and we needed treasure. When I returned from Plataea on that fine spring day, it was to find that one of my greatest loves had died over the winter. The Lydia was too full of rot to be saved. Poor Poseidonos felt responsible, and he was drunk when I arrived, and a huddle of slaves, mostly Indians and Medes, cowered near the boat sheds, expecting my wrath. I was too sad to be angry. I stood for a long time, looking at her upturned hull. The finest ship I'd ever sailed or rowed, the most perfect lines, produced by a genius shipwright at the very lowest ebb of my fortunes. The ship I'd had under my feet at Artemisium, and Salamis, and Mycale. The ship that I'd sailed right into the harbor of Carthage, and out again. When the Lydia, bright paint and vermilion sails, ran at her enemies, they panicked and fled. Her hull strakes and sail were known from Gades to Tyre. And now she'd rotted in 20 places. It was the Teredo worm and poor drying techniques. And I had only myself to blame, because after Mycale, in the hurry of trying to rebuild Plataea and work the soil, I'd allowed her to be badly stowed. Lucas and Megacles came and stood with me. And after a while, I admit that I wept. The next morning, as Megacles sailed for the Diolkos, I decided to try and rebuild her. The Diolkos was only a day's ride away, if that, and I knew that Megacles would be 3 days unloading his cargo, moving it across the isthmus, and getting his crew and hired slaves to drag the vessel. If you haven't seen the Diolkos, it's a stone roadbed across the isthmus, with deep grooves cut in it that match exactly the wheel spacing of the great trucks that the slaves put under the bow, amidships, and stern of your ship. And then they haul it 3 miles across to the Aegean from the Gulf of Corinth, It's a miracle of good engineering, and very handy for rapid movement between two points that otherwise are 10 to 12 days sailing or rowing apart. At any rate, I spent the morning, stripped naked in the good spring sunshine, with 20 slaves, and Lucas and Hector, prying away loose boards and looking at rotten tree nails. But the more we stripped her, the more damage we found. And not all of it was new. The truth is that my beautiful Lydia had seen 3 oceans and put her beak in 20 foes, and she was too tired and old to do it again. Indeed, I began, looking at her timbers, to wonder how we'd survived Mikali. I thought that it might have been lucky that we'd spent most of the summer hauled up on beaches or carrying messages. But here's the point. And I've strayed a long road around, as is my wont. The Lydia's death hit me like the death of a person. And it made me feel old. Her timbers were my timbers. She had made my fame. She was the basis of my reputation. Her rotten timbers were mine. The deep old cracks in her frame represented the aging of my old bones. I would soon reach my 40th year. In Egypt, men are accounted old at 40. And by all the gods and my ancestor Heracles, I'd had no reason to expect to live so long. As I'd thrown my body into every battle rage in the inner sea and the long war. But tears and anger and sorrow accomplished nothing. So that night I ordered a good salmon from the local fishermen. I gathered all my old crewmen who lived hard by and sent to Plataea for my wife and any friends and former crew who happened to be about. And the next night, with Brasidas and Lucas and Megacles as my fellow priests of the cult of the good ship Lydia, with Poseidonos, Kineas, Briseis, Styges, Achilles, and 50 others, we ate a feast, and then Megacles and I set her afire on the beach. Just before I set her alight, Briseis stepped into the middle of the circle we'd made, and took the decorative panel from the front of the marine box over the bow. We'd already stripped the ram, cast in far-off Massalia from tin we'd traded ourselves. But Briseis took the beautifully carved timber, and she and Penelope carried it off the side. Then we all watched her burn, drank our wine, and cried our tears. Afterwards, we lay on our cloaks to sleep on the beach like weary pirates. I hugged Briseis. She was very gentle, and she held me in the darkness lit by the embers of my smoldering youth. I feel old, I said. She touched her lips to my mouth.
Hush, my love. Persian mothers use your name to scare their children.
I chuckled. I'm not sure that's a compliment, I said. She put her hand on mine and carried it to her belly. I thrilled at the touch, and my hand began to move.
We are sleeping in the midst of your friends, on an open beach, she said.
You started it, I accused. She rested her hand on mine.
I'm pregnant, she said.
What? I asked. Someone threw a sandal.
A baby?
I asked, feeling suddenly younger and much, much happier.
And then, you shouldn't be sleeping out on a beach. Don't be absurd, husband. I have borne several babies and slept on innumerable beaches.
I hugged her close. Bless you, I said.
Bless Lady Aphrodite and Hera, she murmured. Now do you feel better about your poor ship?
You and Penelope kept a souvenir, I asked. She laughed her throaty laugh.
I wanted you to have something of her when you build your new warship.
New warship? She laughed. And now her laugh said I was a fool.
I may be a housewife in Plataea, she said. but I do not think that I will remain so forever, eh?
She smiled.
And you, my lord and husband, are the very king of pirates. You will want a ship.
I smiled at her in the darkness, because I knew she was right. I was not dead yet. I'll call her Briseis, I said. This to a woman who'd never bridled at my going to war in a ship named for another woman.
I think you should call her Apollo's Raven,
she said with an edge.
Briseis is my name, not a ship's name.
Right. Gulp. 5 days later, I was lying on a kline in the beautiful, sympositastic space of Aristides Andron. A Persian slave served me wine, and Cleitus, once my dire foe, and Olympiodorus, who had commanded the Epilecti with me at Plataea, and Pericles, the young savant and competent spearman, and half a dozen other rich and powerful Athenians lay around me, and Simon, Miltiades' son, and almost my brother, lay beside me. Jocasta had joined us for a single cup of wine, something that would have been unseemly before the Persian invasion. Aristides was very plainly dressed. Indeed, one of the many changes that war and siege had brought to Athens was a visible change in signs of wealth. I was the only man there wearing an embroidered himation of the old style. Once we had worn the best of our wives' productions, and aristocratic women had, according to men, nothing better to do than weave a beautiful length of butter-soft wool, and then spend 100 evenings embroidering the surface with stars and dots, and in my case, ravens. The war had ended that. Every man present wore white, or off-white, undecorated in most cases, except for a single stripe above the selvedge. In a country where everything had been destroyed, there was a certain equality that hadn't existed before. Or was it the phalanx of free men who had met the Thebans and won, and stormed the Persian camp? Regardless, the days of ostentatious display were gone in Athens. Now, this may seem unimportant to you, but it spoke a great deal for the Athenians that their richest men and women had decided not to flaunt their surviving wealth. They dressed more simply than Spartans, and their simple white clothes said, "Our temples are burnt, and our people are fighting to survive. And women have other tasks than adorning the clothes of the very rich." Clothing can speak very loudly. I was ashamed of my elaborate himation, although no one taxed me in any way. Aristides rose to speak, and first he mixed us a bowl of wine, 3 waters to 1 wine, because we were going to discuss serious business, and then he poured a libation. And we all rose and sang a hymn to Demeter, because it was spring, and never before had any Greeks so valued the fecundity of the earth as we did that spring. And then we settled, and Aristides raised the beautiful black kilix. "We are meeting tonight to speak about the future of Athens," he said, "and with Athens, the future of Ionia." There was a low rumble of assent. In moments, I wished I had Briseis on the couch by me, and not Simon, although not for the usual reasons. She thought deeply and long about Ionia, and the truth was that the Athenians, like many good men, tended to see the world in ways defined by their own experience. Put another way, they wanted what was best for Athens, and they tended to define what was best for Ionia as what Ionia could do to benefit Athens. Simon and I were the closest the Ionians had to speakers at that meeting. Even Aristides seemed to believe the Ionians incapable of governing themselves, as if they had not been rich, independent cities for hundreds of years, when Athens and Sparta were both smaller and weaker. But the essential element of the symposium was a discussion of the role of Sparta. Let me remind you once again that not only had Sparta claimed the right to command by land with her veteran warriors, but at sea, so that while Athens furnished more than half of the hulls for the Allied fleet, Sparta almost always furnished the commander. Such remained the case that spring. Pausanias, the Spartan regent who'd led us at Plataea, and whom I knew to be a member of the Sparta First Party, nonetheless had been proposed to command the Allied effort that year. Sparta intended to furnish 8 ships and the commander, while Athens was expected to furnish 60 ships at least. And the worst of it, Aristides said, is that while we would like to pursue an active war until Persia had neither fleet nor allies within reach of salt water, the Spartans intend to take as little action as possible. He looked around. We'd been at it long enough that all of us had consumed some wine, and most of us were both more relaxed and more garrulous. Simon, who was the proxenos, or representative of Sparta in Athens, wanted to speak, but it was not his turn. Aristides looked at the wall hangings, which depicted Odysseus's return to his home, and Penelope weaving. Sparta does not want to further injure Persia, he said quietly, as if he feared to be overheard even here, in his own home on the slopes of the Acropolis in Athens. Sparta fears Athens more than she desires the freedom of Greece. I shrugged. That was true last year, I said, and Aristides frowned because I was speaking out of turn. Simon took the wine and stood.
As the proxenos of Sparta, it is my duty to remind you that Sparta has contributed as much as Athens.
He shrugged.
As an Athenian, I admit that we had to drag them to fight at Plataea, like old bullocks pulling a broken plow.
I took the wine cup from his hand and drank some. My sons tell me that it's openly discussed in the Peloponnese that Sparta will require the Ionians to move to the west if Sparta is to remain part of the coalition. Aristides smiled.
We'll hear more of this when Themistocles returns from Sparta.
I had wondered where the wily and sometimes dangerous Themistocles was. The architect of victory at Salamis, he was also perfectly capable of carrying on a conspiracy with 3 sides at the same time. And I didn't trust him. Aristides was a prig, and sometimes a prude, but he was also one of the best spear fighters in the world, and his sense of honesty and honor were as great or greater than that of the most punctilious Spartan. It was a matter of bitter irony to me that Themistocles, the epitome of the wily Athenian, was well beloved in Sparta, whereas Aristides, the noblest Athenian, was more feared than loved there. Perhaps men are more comfortable seeing their rivals and foes as caricatures than as men. Perhaps it suited the ephors in Lacedaemon to negotiate with a man who reinforced their views of decadent Athens. Is Themistocles working on a new alliance agreement? I asked. Pericles smiled as if I was a charming bumpkin.
Not exactly, he said.
Even Aristides looked tolerably duplicitous. Simon took the wine cup, drank, and handed it to the wine slave for more.
Themistocles is in Sparta, he said, reassuring the ephors that we will on no account rebuild our long walls.
His words would have carried absolute conviction, except that when we'd landed at Piraeus from Megacles' well-found ship, I'd seen tens of thousands of Athenians of every class carrying stone, even column drums from the destroyed temples, and rubble from destroyed houses. Indeed, the hands of almost every aristocrat present betrayed the kind of dirt and wear and tear that men, even tough men, only experience moving stone. I had reason to know. I'd moved enough of it just clearing the floor of the old temple of Hera in Plataea. But you are rebuilding the long walls, I said. Simon grinned.
And that's why we didn't send Aristides.
Aristides winced. Everyone else laughed. And in that laughter, my friends, you didn't need to be an oracle to hear the distant trumpets of Ares. Simon scratched his nose and looked at me.
Once the long walls are complete, we'll be safe from the Spartans, he said.
Only 4 weeks ago, they threatened us. It was the night before Salamis all over again. They claim that our city is destroyed, that we should relocate ourselves. Indeed, there's a rumor that one of their fears is that we'll relocate and force the Ionians to sail with us.
How can any people so absolutely brave in the face of the storm of spears be so full of fear about issues of statesmanship and diplomacy? I asked. Simon, who genuinely loved Sparta, was silent. Aristides nodded slowly.
Every system has flaws. Their efforts are both a strength and a weakness. In an emergency, the Spartans have the most conservative, and in some cases the least competent leadership. Steady in normal times, terrible when everything is change.
I thought of my teacher, the philosopher Heraclitus. Everything is always change, I said. Nothing ever stays the same. Aristides held his hands wide like a priest.
I hear Heraclitus in you, my friend. And while everything may always be in a state of change, it is not therefore absolutely evil that some old men try to keep things the same. Change for the sake of change is as inane as utter inaction.
He closed his hands. Despite which, in this instance, and for the last 3 years, I confess that I have found the views of the Ephors duplicitous and cautious to the point of insanity. I nodded. Aristides took the cup back from his slave with a slight nod of appreciation. Listen, friends. The long walls make us strong and safe from all our foes, and they will, I think, dissuade Sparta from making any grave errors about us. This is why I agreed to their rebuilding as the first priority, before even our houses and temples. He looked at Simon. But when we are secure, we intend to prosecute the war. It is not over. They burnt our temples and our homes. They enslaved half the women of Ionia as sex slaves. We have defended ourselves nobly. Simon began pounding our kline.
Hear, hear, he shouted,
and all the rest of us joined in. The effect of 10 or 12 bowls of wine, eh? But listen, friends, some of you were there. We defeated the great king. Sometimes it was still hard for us to believe. Pericles almost fell off his couch, he was clapping so hard. But he was young, and so was Olympiodoros. Aristides held up the kilix for silence.
Now we will take the war to them, he said. We will begin with the liberation of the Ionian cities. We will fight to liberate those who want us. Not perhaps every city, but we are not tyrants. If Halicarnassus wishes to remain subject to the great king, we will not attack them unless they furnish ships to fight us.
Music to my ears. My wife and brother-in-law would be delighted. I pledge 3 ships for that fleet, I said. Simon shook his head.
Best day's work my pater ever did getting you the citizenship, he said. I'm to have the command.
And what of Pausanias? I asked.
Simon nodded. "He's a great man and an able commander," he said. "As long as he is willing to fight, we'll be fine." I sat back. "My friends, let me make sure I have this aright. The war with the Medes is not over. We pledge ourselves to carry the war to them, but we're also prepared to fight the Spartans. We'll carry on this holy war under Spartan leadership, unless we find it unsatisfactory, in which case we'll do, what, sail off and make our own war?" Simon nodded. "You know how much we can do." "I know how much we could do as pirates," I said. "And like you and Aristides, I've fought alongside Ionians. We need more of a strategy than you've proposed." Simon nodded, and Pericles spoke up. "The youngest, but already a voice in the councils of Athens." He looked around. He was a dignified youth, and he knew that he needed our assent to speak. But everyone nodded. "First, we take the Bosporus. It's a little like an extension of the Long Walls," he said, waving one hand. He'd had a little too much wine, and he was slurring. "We need the grain from the Euxine to feed all our people until Attica is fit to be farmed again. If we have the grain trade from the Euxine, and we have long walls to our port, we're absolutely secure, and we can use our fleet wherever we want to help Lesbos or Chios." It made sense. The same sort of twisted sense that the Spartan ephors made. "I suppose that to an Athenian, that's the appropriate way to proceed," I said. That shocked them. "But if you're a man of Mytilene, or Chios, or Samos," I said, "it looks amazingly like Athens fortifying herself and then building an overseas empire for her own benefit."
"If we aren't secure, no one is," Aristides said.
"So might any Spartan ephor, prate," I said.
"I thought you just offered us 3 ships, Simon said.
"I did. I just want you to understand that I don't fully agree. Athens is safe. Why the Bosporus?"
"Because we have a democracy,"
Aristides said. "Because our people have been burnt out of their homes and starved on Salamis Island 2 summers. And they want to know that they are secure, and so is the food supply, or we will be voted no money to proceed." He looked at me, and his smile was thin. "And your Plataeans will want the Euxine grain as much as we Athenians."
"We did need the grain."
"Ah, democracy. How soon one forgets." Watered wine never gives me a hangover. So the next morning I was up early, riding down to Piraeus in search of a shipwright and a yard that would build me a beautiful trireme. Athens was building 8 that spring in 8 different yards. And they were all fine vessels, but I was looking for something perfect. It was a God's blessed day, wandering from yard to yard, talking to workers, and watching them cut and shape the timbers and the planks. Athenian ships, most ships really, were built by laying planks to a form, or even a hole dug to shape in the ground, fitting them with biscuits or billets between the planks, just the way an aspis is made, really. When the planks are woven and pegged together, only then does the master builder put in an internal frame to strengthen the hull. Very small boats have almost no frame, and the triremes need a huge internal cable, the hyposomata, kept taut by wedges to keep them stiff and maneuverable, especially in a cross sea that can make a ship flex and its seams open. When Themistocles used the money from the silver mines to build Athens a great war fleet, the shipwrights and designers of Athens had worked hard, and they had cut a great many corners. This might have made inferior ships, and indeed the first ships of Athens' new fleet, copied from Phoenician models, were too heavy, designed to carry big marine contingents. But as they built more ships, faster than any other yards in the world, they came up with new construction techniques, and they began to experiment with designs intended to complement Athenian naval doctrine and the talents of their best captains. In effect, they began to build for speed, not strength, and maneuverability, not marine capacity. I do go on, do I not? But the trireme is in my lifeblood, and I love them, and I love to watch them being built. Sometimes patience is rewarded. The last yard we visited that day was well over towards the old naval port of Phaleron, due south of Athens. Phaleron was more important before Themistocles rebuilt Piraeus. Most of the Persian fleet had sheltered there in the days before Salamis. When they left, they burnt all the yards and naval stores, but two small yards had reopened in the rubble of the destruction. The first was producing fishing boats and stout small boats that would survive a night at sea. The second yard was idle, but on the stocks, about half completed, sat a magnificent trireme, long and low and beautiful. Her planks had all been pinned together, and the ribs were laid lovingly, each one marked with charcoal. A single man was working, lifting a rib, shaving a little wood off and putting it back. I watched him until he had the fit just the way he wanted it, and he walked forward to the next pair of ribs and began fiddling with the port side one of the pair. I walked up. He looked at me through the lattice of ship's timbers. "Hello there," I called out. He waved at me. I saw the glint of his ads. It was polished like a sword blade. I'd never seen a man who polished the head of an ads. "Beautiful ship," I said.
"Nice of you to say so,"
he said, and spat. He picked up a big wooden canteen and took a pull.
"Wine?"
I almost never say no to wine, so I took a pull. Blackstrap, the cheapest stuff you can buy, from the plain of Attica over towards Marathon. Dark as bull's blood, made yesterday by sweating slaves, and tastes of their sweat. The thing is, friends, when you've had no wine for a while, you realize something. I learnt this lesson when I was a slave pulling an oar for Dagon. There's no bad wine. There's wine perhaps you'd rather not drink right now because you can afford better, sure. But when you go without wine for a couple of years, you realize that the gulf between bad wine and good wine is nothing compared to the gulf between no wine and any wine. There it is, all the wisdom of my whole life in a few words. Drink up now. Any road.
"She's yours," I said. "Until one of my moneylenders comes for her hull," he said. "Maybe for building timber, maybe firewood, who knows? Those timbers are mostly seasoned oak, and those hull strakes are Attic pine, dried 3 years.
"You selling?" I asked.
"Are you mocking me, sir?"
he asked. Now I confess that I was dressed to look at ships, by which I mean I was wearing a chiton that Briseis would never have allowed out of the house, tied off with a zone made of old rope. The only sign of my status as a free man, much less a man of property, was a sea knife with a carved bone grip that hung around my neck. No slave would own such a knife.
"Humor me," I said.
He looked it over as if he had never thought of selling.
"I was building it for the fleet," he said. "And then Themistocles told me that he didn't want my hull. Too light, too long."
He waved as if the ship explained everything.
"They don't want the techne to think. They want us to build to a pattern."
Privately, I could see the point. If you'd seen the fleet backwater on the morning of Salamis, you'd know that different hulls work differently, and make it even harder for the various triarchs to keep together. I'll buy her all found and ready to float, I said. I can pay gold. My unnamed shipwright sat back against the timbers of his ship.
Tartarus, brother. I'd have given you wine for nothing. I might even manage a sausage. You don't have to come at the knob.
Gold. I reached into my purse, which I'd tied under my chiton, and hauled out a couple of Persian darics. Gold. His face changed, and for a moment I thought he might cry.
You're fucking serious, he said.
All found. How long?
I need to hire in help,
he said. That's all right, I said. I need oarsmen and marines. I paused and looked back.
One question, I said. You want to know my name?
He asked. Probably a good idea, I said. But why do you polish your ads?
Cuts with more precision, he said.
Damn, I said.
The agora in Piraeus was as busy as it had ever been.
Listen, friends. Themistocles built Piraeus. He found a sleepy fishing village and he made it the best port in the inner sea. The agora, the marketplace, has always been busy. But on that spring day in the year after the battle at Plataea, it looked as if every merchant in the world was there. There were Sicilians, and not just Megacles, although he was one of the first. There were Syrians and Carians, and even Phoenicians. I suspect that if you looked carefully, you might have found a Persian who wasn't a slave. I had a donkey. I'd had the donkey with me all day for just this moment. And now I walked up and down the market, looking at what men had to sell, at who had money. Most of the rich merchants with mixed cargoes congregated together on the seaward side, closest, I suppose, to their ships and the few breezes that might cool us, as if the breeze was the most valuable thing in the world. I stood with my donkey watching them. Some were Corinthian, and some were from sandy Argos, and one little huddle around a table were from Croton, which men argued was the richest city in the world. And opposite them was a table held by six Egyptians. They couldn't legally trade in Athens, but they had a metic, a kind of foreigner with a license to trade, a man from Euboea. The shadows were getting longer when I sat down on a stool. One of the Egyptians smiled at me and made a little brushing motion with his hand. The smile said, "I'm not a fool and I wasn't born yesterday." And the brushing motion indicated that it was time that I moved on in case he had a real customer. Sloppy looking indigent as I was, possibly a bit of a hard case, one of the Egyptians popped into their little trade tent and emerged wearing a sword. I turned to the Euboean. "I'd like to sell you something expensive." He looked at me, a measured stare. "What do you have?" he said. "A golden bowl big enough to bathe a baby in," I said. He smiled. "My master doesn't buy stolen goods," he said. I sat back, ignoring the man with the sword and the man making the brushing motions. "Is spear one the same as stealing?" I asked lazily. That got a chuckle. "Spear one?" he asked.
"I took it from the tent of Artafernes," I said, "when we took the Persian camp at Plataea." The Egyptian, making the brushing motion, stopped.
"Get you gone," he said.
"You really don't want a large golden bowl?" I asked. He made a face.
"I don't want your scheme, your stupid prank, or whatever you plan, Greek. Just walk away."
I looked at him. "When I trade in Heraclea at the mouth of the Nile," I said, "Egyptians are much more polite." He frowned, and the man with the sword walked up close as if to threaten me. It occurred to me that I could have taken it from him and killed him. Jutting your sword hilt at a man and thumping your chest
is incredibly ineffective as a threat. But then I actually wanted to sell the bowl. So I took my donkey and rode back to Athens, where Jocasta made me wash and change for dinner. In the morning, I put on a better chiton and good white sandals and a beautiful chlamys. I went and made some sacrifices, mostly of money, at the temple ruins of Poseidon in Piraeus and such. Then I took my donkey, along with Brasidas and Aten, my Egyptian servant, to the agora. I sat in the same seat and was treated like a different man. I found this to be true so often that I try not to be angered anymore. But honestly, the huge gold bowl had been on the donkey for 2 days and was just as good and just as solid. We haggled for perhaps an hour. They offered wine, which I drank. Not bad, but overwatered. In the end, I got almost 3/4 of what I'd guessed at the bowl's value. Not bad, considering the market. And more than enough to pay for a trireme for a year. We had some sacks of coins. Indeed, you might well point out that I could just have given the shipwright the bowl, but I didn't. Any road, we had sacks, and they went on the donkey, who grunted, and then gave a good bean-fed fart, perhaps commenting on men and their little ways. I walked over to the officer of the Archon Basileus who controlled the market, and paid him for 2 days and an awning.
What will you be selling?
He asked. Blood and fortune, I said. I'm recruiting a crew.
Brasidas wanted me to wait and recruit in Corinth, or even Hermione, where we could get Arcadians and Spartans. But Brasidas, for all of his Lacedaemonian reserve, still believed that all the men of the Peloponnese were superior to all of the men of Attica. I didn't share his views. I knew perfectly well that Boeotian men were superior to both. And you might well ask why I'd recruit new oarsmen, new deck crews, and new marines in Athens when I had so many of my old pirates settled around me in Plataea. But that was the point. I wasn't prepared to sacrifice my friends and comrades of 20 years of war. I wanted them safe at home with their families. And anyway, they were all rebuilding. I put a couple of planks from my new ship across a stack of empty oil amphorae, the big ones, and unfolded my camp seat. On the table, I put my best xiphos, long and narrow, with a very heavy square cross-section near the cross-hilt, and a broader point. The hilt was ivory, banded in gold. The pommel cap was a tiny shrine to Athena Nike, goddess of victory. The ivory had a yellow tinge from years in my hand, and the blood that had flowed over it, polished almost white where I used it every day, practicing my draw. It lay on my best red-purple cloak, the one covered in small, embroidered ravens. Euphoria had made it for me 10 years ago and more, and it was still one of the richest textiles I owned. It had a hole or two, lovingly repaired, but it was magnificent. The cloak and the sword caught every eye in the agora. I sat. Brasidas stood by me on one side, and Megacles stood on the other. It took quite a while before we had our first bite. Men gathered, looked at us, and walked on. I heard someone say, Arimnestos, Plataea, and then someone muttered, Pirate, Miltiades, Lade, Artemisium. I started smiling. Brasidas looked over the crowd. Some good-looking men there, he said. A tall man stepped forward, a crooked smile on his face. He glanced to the right and left, and then walked straight to the table. Here, he said, raising his hand in greeting. It was almost a salute. Here, I said, how can I help you? The crooked smile didn't waver.
I'm told you are recruiting,
he said. I nodded.
Yes, what can you do?
He tilted his head to one side.
I can kill Persians,
he said.
You may not have seen me, but I've seen you.
He held out his right arm, and there was a deep cut, long healed across the bicep.
Artemisium.
Take the sword, I said.
He put his hand on it, and his fingers closed on the hilt.
Brasidas nodded. Name?
The man glanced at Brasidas, and something passed between them.
Leander, sir,
he said.
Aten wrote his name into a wax tablet.
We'll get back to you, I said.
If he was disappointed, he gave no sign. He nodded, and his hand moved, almost a salute. As he moved away, Brasidas said,
Give him credit. First man onto the deck.
We all laughed. Now that Leander had come, they pressed forward, although the sword had its effect. About a third of the crowd simply walked away. The next man up was too old to be a marine. He was over 40, and his eyes were as bright as stars, and he bounced a little, even waiting at the table. His sword arm was crisscrossed with scars.
Marine? I asked.
He shrugged.
I can do things that need doing, he said.
Megacles leant over.
Can you reef and steer?
He asked. The man grinned.
So I can, mate.
Or use that little toy if I have to.
Pick up the sword, Brasidas said. The man picked it up, gripped it the way a man would hold a hammer.
Name?
I asked.
I'm Nestor,
he said,
and most of me mates call me Old Nestor.
You don't seem so old to me. I made a motion with my hand.
Can you stand still, Nestor?
He shrugged.
I can.
I laughed. I liked him already. Megacles handed him a bit of rope. He tied a knot before Megacles could give him direction. Megacles laughed.
Take his name, Aten, he said.
And so it went. They weren't all as clever as Old Nestor and Leander. There were some hard cases, some men demanding money or begging. It grew hot, and Aten went to get us an awning.
I looked up, and there was Sitanax. He stood with his arms crossed, the least Greek-looking man I knew, tattoos, trousers, a gold torque worth about one third of a trireme. I got up, walked around the table, and embraced him.
You want to be a marine? I asked.
He shook his head, a pained look on his Gaulish face.
No, he said. I might come along to see some fighting, he added. I just wanted to introduce a friend.
The man with him was almost, but not quite, as outlandish as Sitanax. He had blonde hair, bright blonde, worn long, and a chiton that had seen better days, and he had a lyre in a bag on his back.
Theodorus,
Sitanax said.
He's from, well, from beyond Gaul. No one here could say his name.
Theodorus smiled.
Here,
he said. He hit the he far too hard. He sounded like a barbarian.
And you want me to take him?
I said.
Sitanax nodded.
Yes. He can row, I suppose. Or fight. He's a gentleman, like me. He wants to be a rhapsode.
A barbarian rhapsode, I said.
Brasidas was moving his hand back and forth across his throat. Sitanax smiled.
I'm fairly certain I've killed enough men to crew a trireme in your service, he said.
Humor me.
It's true that to see Sitanax in action was to see Ares incarnate. I always found it a miracle that he'd lived this long.
Aten, I barked. Take this man's name. Then we picked up a dozen good Athenian oarsmen, all together with their rowing cushions and their backrests, proper oarsmen with massive upper bodies and a certain leer that suggested that they were not to be trifled with.
They came in a clump, but they were so obviously the real thing that I signed them on the spot and sent them to find friends.
Not so many ships this early, their leader said. He was a big brute, Kalimakos, and there was nothing Kali about him, except perhaps his muscles. Prize money?
Maybe, I said.
What's the split?
He asked, a knowing gleam in his eye.
A fair split, I said.
4 shares, one for the ship, one for the officers, one for the deck crew and marines, one for the oarsmen. He grinned and showed his 9 teeth.
A few drachmas for me if I find you 20 more like me.
Did a jail break open? I asked, or are the brothels closed? We clasped hands, and he was off to find more.
Listen, friends, professional oarsmen are like gold. They can row all day, and they can fight. I didn't bother to ask these men if they had weapons. Most oarsmen expect to get those from their ship, and anything they have, they sell as soon as the rowing season is over. They're not nice, but they can row. And before you think too little of them, remember that they won Salamis, not us, the hoplites. And we all knew it. We saw off an arrogant beggar, and then we had a short man who was almost as broad as he was tall. He was covered in tattoos, like a barbarian, but his Greek was smooth and native. He sounded Arcadian. He wore a faded red chiton and had an aspis. Brasidas nodded.
Pick up the sword, he said.
The man reached out and took the sword as if grasping something precious, which of course it was. Almost without intending, he lifted the sword. His fingers wrapped lovingly around the hilt.
Name?
Brasidas asked.
Arios, he said.
We'll want the sword back, I said. He grinned. I was no longer sitting at the table. I was standing by it, chatting with Sithonax, who was bragging of his various conquests. Listen, it may be the height of decorum among Athenians to never kiss and tell, but I gather it is different in Gaul. On the other hand, a few years with Briseis and Jocasta and Gorgo, and quite a few other women, had rubbed off me the interest in hearing these tales. I was probably looking to escape when a big man with a long, sloping forehead and a jaw the size of a horse shoved through the crowd and pushed through the line. He was so big that no one tried to stop him either. He was angry, angry enough that there was foam at the corners of his mouth. His eyes were wild, again, like an ill-used colt.
Ares, Dick, he swore. You're gathering a crew without me.
Truth be told, I would happily have gathered a crew without Leonthos. He was the worst oarsman ever berthed. He broke more oars than a winter storm, and he fought with anyone put near his bench. On the other hand, I was a little scared of him, although I'd never shown it, and he practically worshipped me. So imagine him loose on the deck of a Phoenician. I'd never even seen him take a wound. That's how terrifying he was. He took a great deal of special handling, even among the fractious bastards on the lower oar deck. But then that's what it takes to command a warship, ain't it? Time and thought and experience and knowledge of your people in detail. Leonthos, I said, and put my arms around him. Most of us called him Leon, and that was easier to roar in a fight. Sithonax shook his hand, and Brasidas came and put an arm around him, and then we had to buy him wine and let him sit behind the table with us, his head about 2 hands higher than mine. Oh, I can say no to Leon. I just don't, unless I have to. At any rate, Leon brought us another draft of right oarsmen, and they all insisted on lifting a big stone and tying knots to impress Megacles. And then there were 2 men,
one tall and the other less so. The tall man looked as if he lived by a gymnasium, and the other man looked as if he lived next to a good taverna, despite which he looked fit, and he had a look of keen intelligence that appealed to me. Marines? I asked. They were obviously hoplite class men, from their good wool chitons to their sandals. The tall one nodded.
Yes, sir. Ever served at sea?
Brasidas asked. The tall man showed the scars on his arms, the scars you get in a close fight where your armor can't protect you. I looked at the smaller man. He shrugged.
Usually I let him take the wounds, he said.
I couldn't place their accents.
Where are you from?
Corinth, they chorused. Not my favorite city, but I liked them both. Cheerful shipmates are a great improvement on dour shipmates.
Names? Leon barked.
Zephyridis,
said the tall man.
Because it's an ill wind,
the shorter man said. Never mind, I'm Cassandros. I pointed to the sword.
Pick it up, please.
They both gripped it correctly, and I saw their names written out and passed them down to the group waiting by the waterfront. By then, we had perhaps 50 oarsmen, maybe 10 sailors, and 6 or 7 marines. The crowd was thinner. We'd set a standard. We weren't taking thin, desperate men as oarsmen or beggars. And word had gone out that we were paying hard coin. I'd have my oar banks filled in a couple of days. A boy, or a very thin man, approached us. He was hesitant at first, hanging around the edge of the group of oarsmen. Many of them seemed to know him. Eventually, after we'd seated Leon, he came forward. He was an ephib. He didn't have a beard. Deck crew, he said. He took the sword correctly and tied a number of knots. He had a funny habit of opening his mouth like a fish when he was concentrating.
How old are you, boy?
Megacles asked. Not sure, sir, the boy answered. At least 16.
He was light enough to climb a mast, and I liked his cheerful face.
Name?
I asked. Nestor, he said.
That'll be young Nestor,
Megacles joked, and the name stuck. I was ready to close up. Piraeus in late spring is hotter than the bronze disk of the sun, and I wanted to sit with my new people and drink some wine. But another man walked up to the table. He was wearing a sailor's round cap, and he had a big straw hat on his back.
Can we help you, sir?
Leon said, sarcasm dripping from his huge mouth. Leon made a practice of attacking nearly everyone. Hard man to like. The newcomer was older than me, about my height, and had a bit of a belly. On the other hand, the rest of him looked as solid as the old oak in my new ship's keel.
Daemon, son of Aeneas,
he said.
Second helm, blood of Ares. Prorathes, Athena Nike.
I'd like to be Kubernetes, senior helm.
Megacles raised an eyebrow.
Got anyone from the Athena Nike can vouch for you?
He asked. Half a dozen of our new oarsmen raised their hands.
I can't promise you the rank, I said. The Kubernetes was, after the Triarch, the next in command.
On many ships, he was actually the commander. In most Spartan and many Athenian ships, the Triarch was an aristocrat with less sea time than his greenest oarsmen.
Let's get to know each other. I saw the Athena Nike fight at Salamis. Why are you leaving her?
Daemon shrugged.
She's been broken up, he said.
Worm and rot.
He patted his gut.
We're not getting any younger.
No, we're not, brother, I said. Put him down. I nodded to Athen. I was boiling, and I felt a little like an egg on a griddle. And even Brasidas was miming drinking motions with his hands, when a man stepped up with a woman by his side. He was a tough-looking man with a big smile. His arm was around the woman, who was young enough to be his daughter, open-faced and pretty, and with arm muscles like Athranites.
Women on ships is unlucky,
Leon said. The man smiled.
No, you wouldn't say that to your mother, would you, son?
He said. Leon sat back, abashed. The man leant forward, putting his hands on the table.
I'm not looking for work. I'm looking for a fast passage east for me and my daughter. I've heard of you, Arimnastos of Plataea. Jocasta said I could trust you.
Jocasta sent you? I asked. I was impressed with his handling of Leon. Just the right touch, no hesitation. He smiled.
Yes, sir, she did.
I looked around.
I doubt we will leave harbor for a few days. Ship's not even finished.
He nodded.
Only ship headed east is a lovely round ship with a Phoenician captain. He'll sell us both before we're out of sight of the Acropolis.
I nodded.
Where are you headed?
He nodded.
Lady Jocasta said you might touch at Lesbos or Chios.
I got up and pointed at my stool for Aten to fold. Come and have a cup of wine, I said. I do usually go that way.
I'm going to school,
the girl said. She didn't sound entirely thrilled by the notion.
Sappho's school in Eresos, I asked.
She smiled. She wasn't shy.
Yes,
she said. My wife went to school there, I said. You'll like it. One of the most beautiful places on earth. I nodded.
Right, Aten, get their names.
I'm Gaia,
the young woman said.
I promise we'll be good passengers. We always cooperate.
Socrates, the man said. I build stuff.
Have you built a thirst? I asked. And when Leon growled, I knew the workday was over. I led my new mob to a taverna that looked like it needed business and ordered wine for 70.
It's good to have gold.
The next day, I ate a breakfast of hard bread and a little garlic in Jocasta's kitchen, collected Aten and Brasidas, and walked across the slopes of the Acropolis to the Agora of Athens proper. It was not anywhere near as busy as the Agora in Piraeus. A few farmers selling grain, a dozen young men practicing for a play for the festival of Dionysus, and a group of young men sitting around the royal stoa, listening to Anaxagoras speak on the movement of celestial bodies. All very interesting, if you like that sort of thing. One of the listeners was built more like a Pankrationist than a philosopher, and I watched him watching Anaxagoras with evident interest. Anaxagoras was Pericles's friend, an aristocrat from Clazomenae in Ionia. Although he was not directly a follower of my own teacher, Heraclitus, I was aware that they had sprung from the same ocean, so to speak. Now he was discussing the size of the sun, which he insisted was closer to the earth than all other heavenly bodies except the moon. He had a wizened winter apple and a small round stone, and he was trying to convince his listeners that the eclipse and the things visible during an eclipse proved the size of the sun, which he said was as big as the entirety of the inner sea, or even larger. The stocky man, the Pankrationist, raised his hand.
So you think the world is a sphere?
He said. Anaxagoras shrugged.
It seems the likeliest solution, he said.
The man looked impressed.
I've heard the world described as a wheel, or a circle, he said.
Anaxagoras waved his hands in a vague circle.
You know that sometimes if the light is just right, we can see the shape of the earth as a shadow on the surface of the moon, whether by day or night, he said.
The fighter nodded.
And that shape is a circle,
Anaxagoras said.
Absolutely, the man said. And then, no matter where the moon is, the shape of Earth is still a circle.
Anaxagoras said. The man nodded. Anaxagoras spoke again in his soft Ionian accent. You are a sailor, I think.
I'm a navigator,
the man said, among other things. Anaxagoras held up his apple, reached into the dust and put an ant on the apple. He rotated it in his hand. The horizon, he said simply. The man nodded.
By Poseidon, sir, I've listened to 100 sophists discourse on the clouds, the rain, and the gods. You're the first one who's ever had something intelligent to say. Thanks for the lesson.
He turned away from the royal store, and I stopped him.
A navigator?
I asked. He smiled.
You're Arimnestos of Plataea, he said pleasantly.
You have the advantage of me, I said.
Proxenos of Athens. Hramnos, actually.
He clasped my hand.
I used to own a couple of trading ships. I lost them in the war.
Looking for work? I asked.
He shrugged. Perhaps,
he said.
I'm trying to raise capital to buy myself a ship.
How are you at the coast of Syria? I asked. He nodded slowly.
I can pilot the coast of Syria. And Judea.
Cyprus, too.
I've been into Caria. I used to trade with Halicarnassus.
I smiled. And if I could offer you a summer's cruise and a major profit, I asked.
Piracy?
He asked. I prefer the term war, I said. We're at war with the great king.
He grinned. Best offer of the day.
I was late opening my table, but I took my time, laying my cloak over the table, putting my sword out. Leon came with a big stone. It weighed at least a talent, and I had a bit of a struggle getting it off the dust. Megacles had 2 very different sizes of rope today.
Gentlemen,
I said, we're not recruiting for the Argonauts. We need 100 rowers and another 12 sailors.
We're going to be the first hull in the water,
Megacles said.
Leon grunted. I told my friends,
he said, jerking a thumb at a huddle of big men.
You have friends?
I asked. It was always a little dicey, teasing Leon, but he was in a good mood today.
Of course I have friends,
he said, as if this was obvious to everyone. His friends came forward, mostly young men with statue-like physiques. They lifted Leon's stone. One of them threw it to another.
I see,
I put in. Brasidas motioned to the next man, who proved to be a Sikelioth. He was delighted when Megacles spoke to him in Sikel, and he listened while Megacles spoke of Sicily. He had a scar across his face, and he looked like a fighter, and he was cheerful, if a little slow to speak.
Marine,
I asked. He leant forward slightly. What's the pay? He asked softly. I told him. 3 drachmas a day for oarsmen, 4 for marines, and 5 for deck crew. I told him the way shares would be divided. He nodded. Deck crew, he said.
I have my own armor.
Megacles handed him the 2 ropes of different sizes.
Seize them together,
he said. And then, when that was accomplished, he gave other directions, and the Sikelioth performed them all.
Deck crew,
Megacles said.
Name?
I asked.
Archelaus, he said.
He looked to be as strong as the big oarsman, too.
Want to start earning today?
I asked.
Yes, sir.
I gave him directions to the yard at Phaleron. Take these men and report to the owner of the yard, Alexanor. He'll put you to work on the ship.
Aye, aye, sir.
Ah, the pleasure of being a triarch. About noon, Simon came with 2 other gentlemen. I didn't know them, and so he introduced them.
Aristogeiton, he said. His family were from Illyria, back before Pisistratus.
We clasped hands. Aristogeiton looked like a scholar. He dressed simply in the new style.
He was round-headed and serious, with a certain dignity that can come with age.
A pleasure, sir, I said.
He inclined his head. Aristoyeton has been kind enough to support my trireme this year, Simon said. We heard that you were stealing all the best oarsmen and came down to investigate.
Aristoyeton laughed.
Simon is afraid you have all the best oarsmen. I'm afraid I've invested in the wrong pirate.
I glanced at the other man.
If this is Aristoyeton, is this then Harmodius?
Well, I thought it was funny. Brasidas laughed too, but he's a very polite man.
Aristoyeton gave me a look as if he'd heard it all before.
The other man was taller, with sandy hair and a constant smile. Antenor, he said. Mostly, I'm a farmer.
He was looking at the agora.
Simon met my eye. You stole one of my officers, he said.
Just like a little band of brothers, that's us.
I'd sailed under Simon's father, Miltiades, the biggest pirate Athens has ever produced. And the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, I promise you.
Damon, son of Aeneas, I asked.
My second helmsman, Simon said.
I nodded. I didn't twist his arm. He wants to be Kubernetes, and I expect that he'll make the grade.
Simon stepped closer to me. Don't you think it might have been polite to ask me?
Now, before I take this recollection any further, let me say that over the course of a dozen sea fights, Simon and I have saved each other's lives a few times. I count him as more than an ally, a friend.
I might have if you'd been around,
I said softly.
On the other hand, he's a free citizen of Athens, I believe.
Simon looked at me and looked away.
Damn it.
I smiled. Simon, if you want to keep him, make him an offer. I won't stop him. I can find another officer.
Privately, I thought if he wants to go, just let him go.
I was watching the next candidate.
He was a big man, tall, heavily bearded,
and he was blonde. Blonde men just aren't that common in Athens. Thrace is different.
And you're going to have all the best marines, Simon muttered.
So set up a table, I said. Hell, Simon, take part of my table and start recruiting for the Athena Nike.
Simon wanted to be angry at me, but good humor won out.
See if I don't, he said.
You need wine?
Always, I agreed.
Back at my table, the big blonde man was grinning as if being recruited was the most fun he'd ever had.
Calidion, he said. I used to be called Dion, but some people added Cali.
I laughed. It was no worse than my jokes.
Marine, no doubt, I asked.
He nodded. I have my own armor, he said, and I can cook.
Brasidas managed the smallest of smiles.
I like men who come with extra skills, I said.
Calidion nodded.
And I can read and write, he said.
I pointed him to Aten.
Put him down, I said.
That's all our marines, Brasidas said. I'll start training them tomorrow.
He took Calidion and went off to find the others. They were easy to find. Most of them were a head taller than the crowd, and Leander stuck out from 50 feet away. In the time it took a man to deliver an entire court case, or less, Simon had set up a table next to me. His timing was perfect. I was almost done. There were dozens, if not hundreds, of first-rate men left, and they might have grown anxious. Simon was a very rich man, and he announced that he'd be paying a bounty for every recruit. I left before there was a riot. I wandered down to Alexanor's yard with Aten carrying my stool behind me. I had grown too used to Aten, the perfect servant. I needed to let him go before I couldn't find my own chiton anymore. But that was a problem for another day. Alexanor now had more labor than he needed. I knew that as soon as I saw a pair of oarsmen sweeping the yard. Sweeping dirt is almost always an exercise in frustration, at the very least. Usually an indication of overemployment. I didn't really care. I'd got the golden bowl at the end of my spear, not the sweat of my brow. The transformation in my trireme was incredible, though. Let me say, in my usual discursive way, that most sailors, at least the kind we'd hired as deck crew, were also carpenters and ship maintainers, and perfectly capable of building almost anything that could float. Now, under the direction of Damon and Alexanor, they were laying cross timbers into the beautifully fitted ribs, and the shape of the rowing frame was starting to appear. Most of the timbers were cut and only needed precise fitting, and Alexanor appeared more than a little stressed, running from point to point. But the smell of fresh wood shavings and pine pitch was intoxication to an old pirate, and I stood there for as long as a priestess dances for Artemis at Brauron, breathing in the new life of my new ship. After a while, Alexanor came and stood by me. He still had the polished adze in his hand. "How long?" I asked. He made a face.
I ordered.
He looked around.
"All the cordage?" "Yes, I ordered the cordage this morning. Rope walks aren't busy now. You need a whole set of sailing tackle. Need a mast, and mast has to be sized. Need oars. I was going to make them myself."
"That'd take too long," I said.
"But that would take too long," he agreed. "So, with your permission, I'll just hire 4 oar makers and have them work here."
I called Megacles, who knew more about building ships than I ever would. "Any advantage to fitting the oars to the rowers?" I asked. He frowned.
"No,"
he said.
"Terrible idea."
"Well, so much for innovation." "Good. Hire the oar makers." "How long?" I asked.
"All these people,"
Alexanor said. He waved at the yard.
"And where are you getting sails?"
"All these people are helping," I pointed out.
"I think she'll be ready to swim in 7 days.
7 days? I asked. "How about 4 days?
"In 4 days we celebrate the new festival of Artemis," he said. "No one will work that day."
I rolled my eyes. "What new festival of Artemis?" I asked. "You Athenians and your endless festivals." Jocasta leant over.
"Hold still," she said.
There I was, the virtual pirate king of Athens. And I was holding Jocasta's wool, sitting in the old women's quarters on a balcony. I admit it was not unpleasant, with a cup of wine and Jocasta's company. My hands were too hard and too full of little nicks and rough skin to be really good at holding her soft, long-fiber wool. But I swear she took a special pleasure in having me in the role.
"So why do we all have to take a day off for the Munichia?" I asked.
"If your daughter were here, she'd be sure to tell you,"
Jocasta said.
"Hold still."
The next few days were, to be honest, delightful. Fitting out a ship, a good, handsome ship, is one of the joys in a sailor's life. It's work, but it takes in all the elements of a good party, including a little wine. The men from the rope walks were happy to have the work. Of course, the Persians had burnt all the rope walks, but they're not that hard to construct. And we started getting coils of beautiful brown-white hemp by the 3rd day. The masts and spars came in, too, cut from the slopes of Parnassus. The boatswain mast only as tall as 3 tall men standing on one another's heads, the mainmast half as tall again. I put an inverted cone of bull's hide up the mainmast.
A man standing there can see a long way at sea. Of course, the man had to get there, and that demands a monkey-like agility. But I had Aten, and I planned to recruit a few more boys just for the task. The oar makers came and sat on the ground in the yard with spokeshaves and little saws and sharp knives. Oar wood was delivered in bundles of split-out boards, and they got to work, every oar made by hand. They were astoundingly fast. You could actually see an oar, a beautiful, slim, flexible oar, come out of the wood, as if it was just hidden inside that board and the oar maker was releasing it. And you might well ask what I was doing. Don't imagine that I was directing work in the yard. The old boat builder shooed me along like a good housewife moving her husband out of the kitchen. But as he sent me gently on my way, he did mutter that I'd be needing sails, and that might be a tall order. This time I took the hint, and I walked up from the yard all the way to the Agora in Athens. A good stiff walk, let me tell you. Going back and forth from the city to the port was restoring my leg muscles, at least. Any road, Simon and Megacles agreed that the best sailmakers were up in Athens. So I walked up and found the men who wove sails. Boat sails are often boiled wool, sometimes foreign hemp, but the mainsail is a major piece of work. Many gores wide in heavy linen canvas. Each gore or width of cloth is the work of many men or women for a week or more. A mainsail is an expensive item, and also a matter of pride. I negotiated with three different outfits. Weaving interests me, and in Plataea, women do all the weaving. Although in Athens, you see more and more men in the trade, especially sails and nets. I'm off my story as usual, so suffice it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.